Coming to us out of the sky, the familiar voice of radio brings endless hours of entertainment,
repetition,
information, and cheer.
And Donald Trump's latest tweet.
In every home, its magic moments are an indispensable part of daily life. The setting of one dial brings music. Another, the morning's news bulletin.
And another brings left-wing socialism propaganda.
A housewife turns to shopping hints. Another makes notes of a new recipe.
Okay, those formats will never work.
A man gets the day's market trends or latest sports reports.
Florida State has just impregnated another Hooters waitress.
Or a shut-in smiles and relaxes to that morning word of cheer.
Delilah.
Behind the scenes, a vast and skilled organization and intricate technical apparatus produce the miracle of words and music coming to us through the air.
Behind the scenes are a group of burnouts and dropouts making minimum wage.
But the entertaining hours of radio have not been with us always.
We didn't always have shopping hints and recipes.
Back in 1920, in a dimly lighted room over his garage, Dr. Frank Conrad built and operated the first experimental broadcasting transmitter. Here, radio broadcasting was born.
He invented Rush Limbaugh.
This brilliant Westinghouse scientist had no intention of going into the broadcasting business as he sent phonograph music over the air. He was working on the wireless telephone.
He was working on the wireless boner machine.
But these first whispers of the voice of radio were not unheard as they were broadcast by Dr. Conrad. A surprising number of letters were received from unsuspected listeners, also pioneers, who had improvised primitive crystal sets.
There was an entire team of recluses listening to the radio, waiting for it to be invented.
The world's first radio audience was in the making.
Can't understand what that boy does with all his time. Fooling with wires and that silly thing on his head.
Mom, Dad, come quick. Dad, quick, listen, there's music on the air.
Well, if that don't beat the... Any idea where it's coming from, son?
From Wilkinsburg, just outside of Pittsburgh. A Westinghouse engineer by the name of Conrad is sending it. Isn't it swell? Boy, well, I have something to tell the fellas tomorrow.
Hey, guys, I didn't get late again.
Encouraged by the interest which his experiments had awakened among his unseen audience, Dr. Conrad expanded his work in the little laboratory over the garage. One night, in the basement of a Pittsburgh department store,
Sean Hannity was invented.
A clerk was listening.
More people knew about these programs, perhaps there'd be more wireless parts sold. That's an idea.
Not a good idea, but an idea.
The result of that idea was the first newspaper advertisement to promote the sale of wireless parts. And from that advertisement, one man caught a vision. That man was H.P. Davis, vice president of Westinghouse, soon to be known as the father of radio broadcasting.
Hey, RBG, I think we just found out who your real dad is.
Then we are agreed, gentlemen, that the possibilities of wireless go far beyond its use in private communication. That we will establish a system of mass communication with regular programs in the public interest. News, weather reports, music, speeches.
This guy makes radio come alive.
All manner of entertainment we will send over the air. We will establish a great new public institution. We'll call it...
Hooters.
Broadcasting.
A bold and pioneering decision that was. And the result was immediate action. In less than 1 month, radio station KDKA was on the air, bringing to a few hundred people, practically all of whom had built their own receiving sets, the world's first scheduled broadcast.
A few hundred people? I don't even have that many listeners.
We are bringing you early election returns. North Atlantic states give a substantial lead to Warren Harding over James Cox.
Almost overnight, radio graduated from a hobby to a national institution. Receivers with tubes began to replace the homemade crystal sets. And when there weren't enough earphones to go around, Mother's mixing bowl came in handy as a loudspeaker.
You can make a radio omelet.
Yes, regular programs did create a widespread desire for radio sets. So much so, in fact, that manufacturers couldn't meet demand. People began to expect interesting programs on the air.
People were asking for too much.
Radio broadcasting became an industry, which kept pace with the trend of the time. Westinghouse pioneered this growth of radio, beginning with the first broadcasting station, KDKA.
As more service through radio became practical, Westinghouse added other stations. WBZ, Boston.
The Buzz.
KYW, Philadelphia.
Home of Crusher and the Fish in the Morning.
WBZA, Springfield.
I could listen to call letters all day.
WOWO, Fort Wayne. KEX, Portland. WBOS, International Shortwave Station at Boston.
Broadcasting swept the country until by the middle 20s, over 500 stations crowded the radio map.
They were all immediately purchased by Clear Channel, and that's the history of radio.